It was so sad, so lonely. I watched so many people pass through there. Some lost arms and legs. A few died. Sometimes someone made it over the border. Later, when I remembered the camp, it was almost like a dream. A boy from Kurdistan, dancing with his blanket in the wind. And the way that even when the refugees came back gassed or injured, they talk to me so warmly, and laugh and sometimes sing. I'd rarely known people so dignified and strong. At first, they thought they'd be welcome. Pushed on from every country, they'd attempted for months to get to England. That year I went with them. We were cutting holes in the perimeter fences, running through the grass towards the trains. They were trying to reach England all night, and when the police caught them and brought them back to the camp, they'd wait a few minutes and set out on the road again. I remember a teacher from Baghdad. He'd been traveling for 2 years. He told me in the Turkish mountains the helicopters had ambushed them, and some people died fleeing through a field of mines. It was too difficult. He left his family one by one in the snow. And there were children. They had no one waiting and nowhere to go. One boy from Kabul was my friend. He was with his younger brother. They'd lost their parents near the border of Pakistan. Often it was hours of waiting. Then someone would appear to say police were approaching. The refugees were hidden through the fields, like a human chain. One man, Omar, he went mad. He stopped coming out to the fields. And when his friends tried to persuade him, he'd tear blankets and throw things at them. They talked to him, but he didn't reply. Sometimes, when I lost them running from the police, I was suddenly afraid. The searchlights and the sound of dogs, the anger of the smugglers. I lost Abdullah and Mohammed. I never find them again. With the camera, it was difficult. I couldn't see if trouble came behind me. And many times out of nowhere, a stranger took my hand. I ran with so many people. And each time someone was killed or injured, I always worried it was one of them. Some nights, if the police caught them near the trains, they held them to the ground and sprayed their eyes with gas. Then I'd find blind men crawling around with swollen faces. In spring, they increased the border patrols. All night, they arrested people and drove them back to the camp. And there were rumors it was going to close. The refugees were terrified they'd be rounded up and sent back home. Even when it was impossible to cross, they kept going out to the fields. There was nothing else for them to do. That winter, they closed the camp, but hundreds kept arriving. They were sleeping in the streets, and the police tried to frighten them.
Lâchez-moi! Lâchez-moi! mission!
Later, the refugees went underground. They hid in bunkers and in holes in the fields. There the police did what they wanted. Sprayed gas as they slept, set fire to their clothes. It was violent. I watched whole groups of people disappear from there. I remember sometimes local people used to drive past the camp, shouting and throwing cans of beer. Later, I read that more than 60,000 refugees passed through there. There were a few women, but I didn't know them. They went in trucks with smugglers. The way through the fields was too hard. Once one saw me and waved and smiled, but the smugglers rushed her on. Often I thought of that little girl on the road. I wondered what she'd remember, where she was now, what she would be. They told me that after, they wouldn't tell anyone how it had been. Not a relative, nor their closest friend. They wanted to forget. Every now and then, I hear from them. They call from Hastings, Margate, Manchester. They don't like England very much. They thought it would be different. Months later, you write me. You tell me sometimes walking down a street, it all comes back to you. And you walk all day, and you think maybe you're not strong enough. And the people who live among you, they don't know anything. You cannot tell them you were in Sangatte.